Well, good morning. And all of you moms gathered with us today, happy Mother's Day. It's kind of fun as you watch people walking in to see how many of them have their kids. Even if their kids are grown and gone, this is a day where many of you are back celebrating with mom. So we are in a series as a church reading through the book of 1 Peter, and we're going to carry that today into 1 Peter chapter 3, under the theme, Living Apologetically. But it's not the way that we typically think of what it means to be apologetic, and we'll explain that more as we go through our service today. So let's stand, let's welcome each other to worship, and then stay standing as we sing, Stand Up for Jesus. Stand up for Jesus today. We gather in his name, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. You, God, have claimed us and cleansed us to be your people through the waters of baptism. By your Spirit, give us hearts and minds to hear your word. Give us eyes and ears to see and listen to our world as you view and hear it. Give us words and actions to share the hope we have in you. Let us confess our sins to God our Father, seeking his forgiveness through our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we confess to you that we fall short of the calling that we have received from you. As your dearly loved children, we have struggled to share the reason for the hope we have in you. We have not always responded to others with gentleness and respect. We have failed to live and share the love we have first received from you. Forgive our sins for Jesus' sake, and lead us to live lives that reflect your indwelling presence. Our God hears our prayers and forgives our sins because of Jesus' perfect life, death, and resurrection. At the command of Christ and through the power of the cross and the empty tomb, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. Alleluia. Amen. You may be seated as we hear from our handbell choir. Thank you.
The New Testament reading is 1 Peter 3, verses 13 through 22. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your words, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently for the days of Noah while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, 8 in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him. This is the word of the Lord.
We join in singing our sermon hymn, We Are Called to Stand Together.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you call us to stand together, to stand unapologetically upon the truth of your word. Lord, help us to have ears that hear that and live it out. In your name we pray. Amen. One critical comment is all it takes. You can be doing the right thing, and then somebody else sees it as the wrong thing, and they make one critical comment. And all of a sudden, you're not in a good place. You ever been there? In the world that we live in, especially with social media, there are so many times where I have posted something. Something where I have sought to point to Jesus in that. Something on my personal social media site, something on one of our church social media sites, and there's someone who posts that critical comment. And all of a sudden, I'm not in a good place. Like, it hurts. It stings. So what do we do? Like, as Christians, what do we do when we find ourselves criticized? That's the question that I want to lean in and look at with you today as we continue through our teaching series in 1 Peter. We're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. Listen to what Peter writes. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? Most of the time we'd say no one, but that's unfortunately not always the case. And so he continues, even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. So how do we respond as Christians when we're criticized? I want to draw out three comments that Peter makes from this text. And all three of the comments start with the letter R. He says we need to recognize, we need to revere, and we need to be able to reason. So let's just take those apart one at a time. The first one is this. We need to recognize that we will be criticized. So Peter speaks in verse 16 of those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ. So in the first century culture, we see Christians being increasingly marginalized and maligned and even maliciously attacked. Why? Because their religious beliefs and practices didn't align with the culture around them. And here's the thing. When you don't fit in, when what you believe doesn't match up with what the culture believes, when what you practice doesn't match up with what the culture practices, when you don't fit in, you will be forced out. Just take water and oil, two different chemical compounds. You put them together and you mix them up. They don't mix, do they? Give it some time and the oil gets pushed out. It gets pushed to the top. This is us as Christians in the culture that we live. Yeah, we're mixed together with all different beliefs and practices, but give it enough time. And when people pay attention to what you believe, teach, and confess, and the way that you practice your faith, they will begin to force you out. Peter speaks of this further in chapter 4. Verse 4, as he says, they are surprised that you don't join with them in their reckless, wild living. And so because of that, what do? They heap abuse on you. They criticize you. When you don't fit in because you're doing the right thing and yet other people see it as the wrong thing, you will be criticized. And I start here because I think sometimes we're shocked. We're shocked when we receive negative comments on social media. Like, why would somebody make a comment like that to me? Don't be surprised. Don't be shocked by it. Instead, be prepared for it. Be ready for it. Recognize that you will be criticized. And then here's the second thought that Peter pulls out. We need to revere rather than fear. So verses 14 and 15, he says, even if you should suffer for what is right, do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened, but instead, in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. So when we are criticized, we have to make an intentional choice. Whose words do we care more about? Do we care more about what they say to us, or do we care more about what God says to us? Because either you put Christ on the throne and you bow to him, or you put somebody else and their thoughts and their opinions of you on the throne and you bow to them. So Jesus says in Matthew chapter 10, verse 28, as he's talking about the suffering that his disciples are going to experience as they faithfully follow him, he says these words, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both body and soul in hell." And then later in verse 32, he says, "Whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before men, I will disown before my Father in heaven." See, either we're going to be criticized by others and commended by Jesus, or vice versa. And so when we suffer, we have to put their threats in perspective. Who do we care more about? Do we care more about them and what they say, or do we care more about what Jesus says to us? So Peter says we revere Christ rather than fear men. So step one, we recognize that we will be criticized. Step two, we revere Christ rather than fear others. And then step three, and we're really going to spend the bulk of our time together on this today, we need to be able to give a reason for the hope that we have. So he says in verse 15, "Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect." So when he says, always be prepared to give an answer, the Greek word for answer is the word apologia, which is where we get our word apology. So the title of this message is Living Apologetically. But what does that mean? Because we live in an English-speaking culture where we understand an apology one way. We think that an apology is us saying that we are sorry for the wrong that we've done. But actually, here in the Greek language, it means exactly the opposite. The word apology simply means a defense. So think of being on trial, and you are being accused and criticized. How do you stand up for what you believe is right? That's an apology. And this is something as Lutherans that we've been doing throughout our entire history. Because if you look back about 500 years to some of the confessions that were being written in a world that criticized us, one of them is written by Philip Melanchthon and it's called The Apology. And in that, he's not apologizing. He's simply standing up and saying, this is what we believe, teach, and confess, even in a world that criticizes that. We need to be ready to live apologetically, to stand upon the truth of what we believe, teach, and confess in a world that sees otherwise. And sometimes living apologetically is done with many words. We enter into conversations, we have arguments, we reason things out with others. But then there are times where we live apologetically with only a few words. I'm someone personally who loves the study of apologetics. I love being able to take the questions that people have. I love being able to talk about where our culture stands on certain issues, some of the ideologies and the philosophies and the thoughts that people have, and to go back to Scripture and to wrestle with how do we make sense of this in Jesus. And there's a place for that. We need to be able to do that. And so in your bulletin, I gave you just a number of different resources that you can turn to, that you can dig into. And one that I just point out for you this morning is a book that recently came out called Mama Bear Apologetics. And I think about celebrating Mother's Day this weekend, one of the responsibilities that we have as parents and especially as moms is to be able to empower your kids, as the tagline says, to challenge cultural lies. To see that we're raising kids in a world that is teaching them false ideologies, and how do we come back and give them the confidence so that they can stand upon the truth? That's living apologetically. And there are times where we need to reason those things out with each other. But sometimes living apologetically only happens with a few words. Because we live in a world that doesn't want to argue with us. They don't want to engage in the conversation. And so sometimes studying apologetics is simply to give us the confidence so that we can go out to the world and speak very simply the name of Jesus. Because that's how we live apologetically, understanding that Jesus is the answer. Jesus is our apology. Jesus is our defense. Jesus is our hope. In a world that tells us what is wrong, we simply point them to the truth in Jesus. See, we look to the story of Jesus, and we see in that that his story becomes our story, and his story gives us a living hope in a dying world. And when you look at the story of Jesus, here's what you see. You see a man who is criticized, right? Throughout Jesus' ministry, he's insulted, he's marginalized, he's maligned, he's maliciously attacked, he's falsely accused, and it gets him crucified. And sometimes that's where you and I end up as well. But that's not the end of the story. Because we see ultimately that Jesus is the victim who is vindicated. And that's the resurrection. And vindication is simply when people spew lies about you, when they speak falsehoods about you, God speaks the truth over you. And so in a story where Jesus is marginalized and maligned and maliciously attacked and falsely accused, the resurrection is God's way of saying, "You're wrong, world. Jesus is right. Jesus is the answer that we stand upon." And verse 18 brings this together for us. It says, "For Christ also suffered for our sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit." And it's the story of Jesus that you and I are drawn into because, yes, we've been criticized, we've been marginalized, we've been demoralized, but guess what we've also been? We've also been baptized. And this is what Peter goes on to speak about in verses 21 and 22 of our text. And what does it mean to be baptized? It means that those promises from verse 18 are spoken over us, that Jesus endured suffering and shame at the cross in order to draw us near to him. And I don't want us to rush past that statement. Because what does it mean to be criticized? It means that somebody pushes you away. So somebody looks at you and says, "You're in the wrong. I don't want to have a relationship with you." And when you are criticized, what you need to remember is that in your baptism, God draws you near. And God says, "You are mine." And the image that I want to put before you this Mother's Day weekend is that of being a mama bear. I mean, you think about what that means for moms in our culture. This is what happens when they see one of their kids being mistreated, when they see them being maligned or marginalized or maliciously attacked. They go into mama bear mode. And what does that mean? It means that they're ready to put everybody else in their place as they then pull their child aside and say, "Don't listen to the lies that they're telling you. Let me tell you who you are. You are loved. You are chosen. You are my child." And that's ultimately what God does for us. That's vindication. At the end of the story, in a world where we are criticized, God's going to go all mama bear. And he's going to put everybody else in their place. And all the wrong words that they've ever spoken, he's going to put right. And right now, he pulls you close. He reminds you that, yes, you've been criticized, but also you are baptized. And that means you are mine. You don't take your cues from the culture. You take your cues from me. So I'll close with this. So there are all kinds of reality TV shows out there, like Survivor or Big Brother or The Amazing Race. And in order to be on these shows, every contestant is mic'd up. And like that mic is on constantly. But most of the time, that footage is edited out because it's boring, because there's not much happening. But when do the producers pay more attention? It's when there's conflict. It's when tensions are heightened. It's when people are going at each other. See, the mic is turned up in suffering. And we need to remember this as Christians. Because there's a world that's listening. And sometimes when we're criticized, we just wish that people would give us our privacy. Just leave me alone to lick my wounds. But I want you to know that people are paying attention. And what if, rather than seeing it as a negative every time we're criticized, what if instead we saw it as an opportunity? An opportunity to live apologetically. An opportunity to give a reason for the hope that we have in Jesus. And to do it with gentleness and respect, to do it in a way that we point to Jesus. Because in the end, it's all we have. Jesus is our answer. Jesus is our apology. Jesus is our defense. Jesus is our living hope in a dying world. Amen. Let's stand this morning. We join together in confessing our faith. Using the words of the Nicene Creed, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. So we go to our Lord in prayer. After each petition, I'll say, Lord, in your mercy, and invite you to respond. Hear our prayer. Lord God, we just spoke those words of confession, saying that this is what we believe. And yet as we join together to speak those words, we know that not everybody confesses them along with us. And because of that, there will be times where we are criticized, where we are marginalized, and where we feel demoralized. Lord, when we find ourselves in those places, send us back to the words from Peter. that recognizing that we will be criticized, we can make a choice, a conscientious decision, to look to you, to revere you, to see that you are the one who reigns on the throne. You are the one who was the victim, and yet you have been vindicated for all time. Lord, help us to trust in you. Help us to take our story and align it with yours. Help us to see that we have been baptized, and you are the hope that we have. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for those who help us to live apologetically, to live confidently confessing the faith. We thank you for the teachers that surround us, especially, Lord, for the teachers that are in our school at St. John's as we celebrated Teacher Appreciation Week this last week. Lord, in those times where, even as teachers, where they're doing the right thing and yet it's seen as the wrong thing by kids or by parents or by others, Lord, renew them, restore them, help them to be faithful to you. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we pray also for moms on this Mother's Day. We thank you for the gift that they are. And yet, Lord, we know that it's often a thankless task because they too take their fair share of criticism. Lord, we ask that you would fill them with a gentle spirit to continue in the task that you have given to them of shaping these lives, these minds to follow after you. And Lord, we pray for those who are not able to celebrate Mother's Day with either a mom or with a child. And maybe it's because of distance, maybe it's because of a broken relationship. Sometimes, though, Lord, we know it's because of death. And so, Lord, comfort all of them. Lord, in your mercy. Father, for those who find themselves grieving today, we especially lift up and remember the family of Lorena Pauley. And as we gather tomorrow to remember her, Lord, we thank you for her life, her faith, and the hope that she had. Lord, help us to, as we gather, point others to that, for you are our living hope in a dying world. Lord, in your mercy. These prayers, Lord, and all others, we lift to you in the name of your Son, Jesus, as he's taught and invited us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as we invite the usher to bring our offering forward this morning. As we receive our offering, we do that both in person with the offering boxes, which are in the back of our sanctuary space, and then also by giving online. There's a QR code that's in your bulletin for that. And as we bring these gifts to the Lord, our handbell choir will be playing for us, Take My Life. Thank you. We think about what it means to invite God to take our life. Ultimately, that's about sacrifice. And when you put yourself in a place where you are a sacrifice, that means you open yourself up to suffering. That's what happens when we find ourselves criticized for aligning our lives with Jesus. And ultimately, as we gather to share this meal together today, we see that this is Jesus. This is the ramping up of the criticism as he's preparing to offer his life as a sacrifice for us. So we remember our Lord Jesus Christ on the night when he was betrayed, that he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, we remember that he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." You know, there's a part of us when we find ourselves criticized, we don't want to respond with gentleness and respect. We want to lash out at them. And there may be some of you today, you're carrying hurt from somebody who has criticized you. It could be recent, it could be more in the past. The proper thing to do with that is not to turn it to the other person, but to bring it to Jesus. And that's what I want you to do today as you come forward for communion, to take it, drop it at the cross, let him take it. He's taken everyone else's criticism. And in that, let him give you a clean conscience. Let him offer to you the forgiveness of sins. So the ushers will invite you to come forward from the middle. We'll form two lines. You'll receive the bread from one of us as a pastoral team. The wine will be placed on the tables in front of you, and then your empty cups can be discarded in the baskets as you return to your seats. We prepare for communion. And now may this true body and blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you, keep you steadfast in the one true faith until life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. And then may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with favor and give you now and always his peace. Amen. Did Jean Thomas come down from the balcony? There's Jean. So Jean, the bulletin says that there's a closing hymn today. There is a closing song that your handbell ringers have prepared. It's the benediction. It's a song that you know well, and I just want you to come and sit in the front so that you can fully take it in. We've heard the benediction, but some of you may or may not know that Gina served as our handbell director for 9 years. This is the last time that she will be climbing up into the balcony to direct the handbell choir. She did a beautiful job today. We're going to let her just soak this in for a moment as we all hear this word of benediction.